Hello, Bloomington. I'm Mayor Tim Busse, and this is the Council Minute for the week of January 17th. With the MLK holiday, we did not have a council meeting on Monday, but we were still busy this week. On Tuesday morning, the city hosted our 2022 legislative breakfast. It's an annual meeting where the city council sits down with our state senators and representatives, our county board commissioner, our Met Council representative, and city staff to talk through the variety of legislative and public policy issues that will be of interest to Bloomington in the coming year. Now, given COVID issues, it was actually a virtual meeting, and since we still haven't found a way to share breakfast virtually, a better name for the meeting would probably be our pre-session legislative briefing. Our guests included the entire Bloomington legislative delegation, Senators Melissa Lopez-Franzen and Melissa Wickland, and Representatives Andrew Carlson, Steve Elkins, and Mike Howard. We were also joined by our Hennepin County Commissioner, Debbie Gattell, and by Bloomington's Metropolitan Council representative, Molly Cummings. Staff presented specifics on a variety of city priorities headed into the 2022 legislative session, including the four components of a potential Bloomington local option sales tax. And as I'm sure you remember, those four components include a significant renovation of Bloomington Ice Garden, a new community health and wellness center to replace our public health building and Creekside, a total replacement of the clubhouse at Dwan Golf Course, as well as extensive course improvements and upgrades, and an expansion of the Bloomington Center for the Arts that would add a concert hall. Staff also outlined city priorities associated with the 494 Vision Project, Expo 2027, expansion of the Housing and Redevelopment Authority Board, and special use taxes in the South Loop. There was plenty of time for questions and discussion of the issues, and our legislators and representatives also shared their priorities and expectations for the upcoming session. Now, obviously, discussions like this are much better in person, but still, this was a very productive conversation. Bloomington is fortunate to have such thoughtful, talented, and dedicated people representing our city, and we're also fortunate to enjoy such a strong and productive relationship with these state, county, and regional level officials. Trust me, not every mayor can say that. Thank you to our elected and appointed officials who work so hard for Bloomington every day. We'll provide legislative updates at council meetings and here on the Council Minute as Bloomington's legislative priorities move or don't move in St. Paul. Two COVID-related headlines caught my eye today. The first is that a Mayo Clinic model predicts that the most recent wave of COVID could peak in Minnesota by next week. That would be good news. The other news item was not so good. Health experts now believe that while the fast-moving Omicron variant may cause less severe disease on average, COVID-19 deaths in the U.S. are climbing, and modelers forecast 50,000 to 300,000 more Americans could die by the time this wave subsides in mid-March. We are not out of the woods yet. So some may ask, why not institute a mask mandate in Bloomington? Folks, the people who are not wearing masks now will not suddenly decide to do so because of a local mandate. If the possibility of 300,000 more Americans dead by mid-March doesn't compel someone to take simple steps to keep their neighbors safe, then a mandate by your city council certainly won't. But that doesn't mean I'll stop asking. Everyone, please, take care of yourself and take care of others. Get vaxxed and boosted. Wear a mask in indoor public spaces, get tested when needed, and stay home when you're sick. Remember, hospitals are full. Don't take chances. Be as low risk as possible. There is no rush in getting those holiday lights down off the house right now. If you need assistance of some kind or feel like you're reaching a point of crisis, know that there is help available. Call the Minnesota Warm Line at 877-404-3190 or text SUPPORT to 85511. The Warm Line is open from noon to 10 p.m. Monday through Saturday. Take care of yourself and don't forget to take care of each other as well. Check in on your neighbors to see how they're doing and if they need any help. If you know someone who has COVID, do the neighborly things like bring them dinner or run errands or shovel or take care of some other task for them. And finally, be prepared for challenges. I know it's hard to make plans when things are changing so rapidly, but it really is important to do so. Take a minute to think through what you might do if you run into issues related to work or school, childcare, healthcare, and more. Common sense things like planning ahead for refills of any prescription medications, finding out where you can get a COVID test before you need one, or figuring out a plan B for your specific circumstance if something should go wrong can make things a lot easier when the unexpected hits. Challenges persist, but we are in a much different place than we were 2 years ago. Our community as a whole is highly vaccinated, which means strong protection against severe illness and hospitalization. We have learned so much about COVID, and we now have the tools to help us stay safe. We will get through this tough time. Things will get better. Please take care of yourself so we can keep taking care of each other and our community. And finally, Monday was, of course, Martin Luther King Day. I read a proclamation at our council meeting on January 10th, acknowledging that Dr. King's message is as relevant today as it has ever been, and that his message evolved over time from one of civil rights, of voting and desegregation, to advancing labor rights, economic and social justice, and peace and dignity for all. The proclamation also encouraged all residents to honor and remember Dr. King for his humanitarian values and to work toward that realization by attending the National Day of Racial Healing virtual event, which took place on January 18th. This was the third year Bloomington has participated in a National Day of Racial Healing event, and it was the first time we did so in partnership with the cities of Edina and Golden Valley and with the Healing Justice Foundation. Dr. Joy Lewis, president and CEO of the Healing Justice Foundation, was the keynote speaker, and her talk prompted a lively conversation on how to create a more just and equitable world. Thank you to everyone who participated. That will do it for this week's Council Minute. Thank you once again for tuning in. Until next time, stay safe, Bloomington.